Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. The session is about to start. Please take your seat. Var vänlig och ta era platser.
Start now. What if you start with a bit of less light so people see difference?
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the opening session of the ALDE Party Congress in Stockholm. Please welcome with applause the ALDE Party co-presidents Timmy Dooley and Ilhan Kyuchyuk.
Just get everybody seated.
A minute more. One more. All right. Dear Liberal friends, it's our honor and pleasure to welcome you here in Stockholm for ALDE Party Congress today. The ALDE Party Congress is a highlight of our year. It's when we all get together, liberals, from every part of Europe to share our experience and new ideas. It's a war like a big family reunion, a chance to reconnect, to learn, and to celebrate what it means to be liberal. But we meet at summer time. It's almost been 18 months since Russia decided to do unthinkable. This war marks the most somber moment in our era, as it signifies not only the beginning of Ukrainian war of independence, but also the beginning of a war of democracies against autocratic regimes. Autocrats and wannabe strong men have become the emboldenment around the globe. When Xi Jinping, Vladimir Putin, or Khamenei, they are actively subverting democracy. They are undermining human rights we have fought for decades to give. They are ignoring international law. Worse yet, democratic backsliding is not restricted to some faraway countries. Right here in European Union, we have autocrats like Viktor Orban, who make it their mission to do away with these values. Dear friends, I grew up in Bulgaria during the communist times. Growing up under communism gives you a different perspective. It makes you understand that no people or country are immune to history. It makes you understand that history is not just a thing of the past. Communism was ultimately defeated because of coalition of democracies stood against autocratic regimes. What came after was a period where liberal values laid the foundation for peace and prosperity in our continent. And yes, we Europeans largely took this peace and prosperity for granted. We thought democracy was given. We thought that the only issues left for those of us in politics were those of economy, inequality, and climate change. But then, in February 24th, gave us a clear reminder that autocratic forces remain strong. A reminder that if you want our liberal values, democratic values, to exist, we have to protect them. A reminder that, yes, sometimes we have to use force to protect them. And we can only protect our liberal values by nurturing them. Both as citizens and elected politicians, we have to tend for democracy and fight for it. As things change, we have to be willing to look at ourselves with a critical eye, making reforms that can allow democracy not just to survive, but to thrive. Contrary to its aims, Russian aggression against Ukraine was bolstered our security. As a result, the Baltic Sea, which you can see from this conference center, actually, got the new NATO member with Finland. This has made us all safer, I would say, collectively. It is only a matter. It is only a matter of time before Sweden joins the North Atlantic Alliance. But unity, liberal friends, it is a matter. But unity, dear liberal friends, is not a goal within itself. It must have a goal forging a common destiny. Standing tall in the face of adversity, the unyielding resolve shown by the Ukrainian people outshine everything else. The collective duty of Europe, in essence, is to bolster and to sustain their unshakable spirit. Friends, we are now in a period where crises are a new normal. But at the same time, mustn't be shy of about the achievements that Europe has accomplished in the past years. We have been through a once-in-a-generation pandemic. We purchased the vaccines together and made sure those who needed care got the care they needed. We saw European solidarity at its best, with Belgian patients being treated in German hospitals. Czech deliveries of masks and respirators to Spain. Doctors and nurses coming out of retirement to care for their fellow citizens. I could go on and on. We've had a war and an energy crisis, which has led us to reevaluate how quickly we must move away from fossil fuels. There too, Europe has shown time and time again that it can deliver. We live in some ways in a paradox. Collectively in Europe, even now, you see the highest standards of living of any group of people in the history of the planet. We have never been better educated, healthier, and wealthier.
But citizens don't want to hear how great things are when they're still struggling to pay their energy bills or put food on the table. They don't want to be told that investing billions in healthcare when they have to wait for weeks for a doctor. Voters don't want to hear how our economies have recovered from the COVID pandemic in terms of GDP when they no longer believe their children will have a better life than they had themselves. So this, ladies and gentlemen, takes me to 2024. Dear friends, the ALDE Party is only as strong as the sum of you, the member parties. While the ALDE Party consistently provides support to our member parties, it's during the European elections where our collective influence truly shines. United, we make a profound impact. 2024 will be a year for those decisions. There are parliamentary and presidential elections in 7 member states of our union. But between June 6th and June 9th, 2024, every European member state will get the chance to vote. People will have a say in what kind of Europe they want to live in. That's why we've been working really hard to deliver on a European election manifesto. A manifesto that we believe we can be proud of taking back and for you to use in your specific and individual campaigns. The process has been open, it's been inclusive. We're involving citizens, NGOs, member parties, the youth, to share their feedback and to help us build a political programme that will help us win elections. Because that's what we're about, ladies and gentlemen. It's about winning elections. Our Vice President, Sven Johan, is doing an amazing job in chairing this manifesto drafting committee, representing all corners of Europe, both EU and, really importantly, non-EU. Whether it's about scripting the future course of globalisation, a phenomenon that's intricately linked to economies and our societies, or strengthening security and defence mechanisms that ensures a safe and peaceful society for all. ALDE is committed to making a difference. Our manifesto delves into the challenge of creating a more sustainable economy, one that ensures prosperity for all while reducing our environmental footprint. We understand too that striking the balance between economic growth and environmental sustainability is not an easy task, but we're undeterred. We cannot fail. We must deliver. As Liberals, we embrace new technologies and indeed practices that can help transform our economic systems without causing harm to our planet. When it comes to building a resilient labour force, we've focused our lens on creating a flexible and inclusive and dynamic job market. We aim to empower workers, enabling them to adapt to a rapidly changing economic landscape. Our manifesto, I believe, addresses the need for continuous learning, upskilling, and lifelong education to help our labour force stay competitive in what is this digital age. Moreover, the scourge of corruption that undermines the integrity of our institutions and threatens our very democracy is something that we're committed to combating in a fierce way. We believe in the principles of transparency, accountability, and most of all, the rule of law. And these principles permeate our policies and our strategies. The ALDE Party, through its election manifesto, is determined to tackle these significant challenges head on. Our vision is liberal. Our approach is progressive, and our resolve is steadfast. We'll focus on making Europe safer for everyone. We plan to enhance our defence and security systems, both online and offline. We also aim to establish a stronger presence for Europe globally. We'll work to improve our trade policies and to build solid and beneficial relationships. We've also made sure to coordinate the process with our partners, the EDP and Renaissance, and indeed other parties. This is just building upon the already existing great cooperation that we have in the European Parliament. We've also been working hard to deliver on a charter of values. And for that, I must say on behalf of the Bureau, we owe a huge debt of gratitude to our colleague and friend, Vice President Sal Britton. The charter is about stating our common liberal values, focusing on the things that unite us more as a family than those things that divide us. The consultations will continue over the coming months, and I want to thank those of you who have already contributed and assisted in that way. Dear Liberal friends, as I said, between June 6th and June 9th, Europeans will stand at a pivotal crossroads. No one hand are those who appreciate and uphold the very qualities that make Europe free and those who want to disintegrate it. Europe will have to choose between those who value freedom and those who want to do away with it. Liberals will always stand on the side of freedom. Europe, dear Liberal friends, is worth fighting for. Thank you so much.
Dear Liberal friends, I'm happy to be addressing all of you today, even if I'd rather be with you in Stockholm in person. It has been over a year since Russia's full-scale invasion of Ukraine. This war has been a clear reminder that we cannot take our freedom for granted. It has been a reminder that the world has entered into a new era. It has also reminded us of something many of us have said for a long time, that today's struggle is actually very simple. It is a struggle between good and evil, a struggle between authoritarianism and terror on one side, and freedom and democracy on the other. Freedom will triumph over evil sooner or later. However, we must work tirelessly to build alliances within and outside Europe, creating a strong alliance of like-minded individuals and nations to overcome these turbulent times together. As liberals, we champion the values of human rights, individual freedoms, and the rule of law. We believe in the power of cooperation and open dialogue to bring about a world where these values flourish. It is through our collective efforts, both within our borders and beyond, that we can foster an environment where democracy prevails and where people can live in peace and prosperity. I hope this Congress serves as a platform for sharing ideas, strategies, and experiences to strengthen our bonds and empower our cause. We must have courage to ensure that the world remains a place where democracy and freedom triumph over the darkness of tyranny. Thank you, and I wish you all an excellent Congress.
Dear friends, here's a message from Belgium, a call to all of you to act. Because if we look at our continent, our beautiful European continent, we see that our shared values are under attack, literally in Ukraine, with bombs and atrocities committed by a power-hungry dictator, but also more subtly in other European countries, where fundamental rights and freedoms are under increasing pressure. We see free press in decline. We see a growing number of people who wish for a strong authoritarian leader. Dear friends, we have work to do. The ALDE Party is the party for liberal and democratic values in Europe. We believe in equality and individual liberty. We believe in diversity, bodily integrity, and consent. We believe in the rule of law. We believe in democracy. We believe in freedom. Our dear friend Kira from Ukraine said, "Hope is the fuel we are running on." And that's true for freedom and peace in Ukraine. But it's also true for human rights and freedom in the rest of Europe. The hope that we can uphold our liberal and democratic values against extremists, populists, and autocrats, that is what keeps us going. Let us keep going. We have 1 year until the European elections. Let's be united and help each other, like we do with Ukraine. Let's be bold in our actions and truthful in our words. I wish you all the best of luck and a fruitful Congress. See you soon.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the second part of the opening session from the Renew Europe Group. Please welcome its first Vice President, Malik Azmani.
Well, 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 dear Liberals, dear friends, gimme, gimme, gimme a big round of applause for our great hosts, Centerpartiet and Liberalerna. What a great venue in a stunning city amongst the very best friends. And let me start by addressing you, Kira, Olga, and Vadim, and the brave Ukrainian people you represent. The brutal, barbaric invasion of Ukraine will be Putin's Waterloo. Our heroes in Ukraine will win this war, and we will not stop supporting them until they do so. With our weapons in their hands, with our rockets in their air, with our tanks in their fields, and now with our F-16s in the skies, you will win. We have welcomed our Ukraine friends in ALDE, and we will welcome them in the NATO, and we will welcome them in the European Union very soon. Slava Ukraini! Mamma mia! What a year it has been, dear friends. Together with our commissioners and members in the Council, Renew Europe is proud of what we achieved. The ALDE has been in the engine room of our Renew Europe group, and our group has been driving the change. Moritz, Katka made sure that breaking the rule of law, Mr. Orbán comes to add a heavy price. Eva and Martin made sure that we invest in a modern economy. Niels and Emma protected the lands, our lands, and the farmers who work on it on a sustainable future. And Sophie and Mika defended the freedom of press on our continent and beyond. All our MEPs have made a difference. Renew Europe has made a difference. Liberalism has made the difference. Dear friends, our very own dancing queen, Nicola Beer, that's you, will leave our New Europe group to become a banker. Well, Nicola, thank you, and don't become a stranger. We need the money, money, money. And our dear friend, our super trooper, Guy Verhofstadt, announced that he will leave, probably politics, at the end of this mandate. And Guy, no one, has stood up for the liberal cause more than you have. There's a big bow for you, Guy. Well, dear friends, take a chance on liberalism and you lose. That much is clear. Therefore, I thank you for the music, dear populists, but your sound like a broken record. The political center is under pressure throughout the continent, but your future, our future, lies not in populism and extremism. And dear Manfred Weber, I have also read the Ten Commandments. And corruption, nepotism, suppression, and illiberalism are not amongst them. Honor your principles and stick to our European ideals. Our middle classes cannot live in houses of lies. They cannot work in factories of fear. And they cannot learn in schools of disinformation. Take a chance on liberalism, democracy, and the rule of law, and we all lose. That much is clear. But dear friends, we have a future together, and that future is called Europe. Voulez-vous? Haha. Well, that's the question. We started an adventure with the French in 2019. And like a soufflé, it's not easy to get it right. It takes time to perfect the recipe, to make that bloody thing rise instead of implode. And risen we have. And we are great to our ALDE Party co-presidents that we now have a common electoral platform and will fight these elections together, as one, as Renew. And next year, we have an important election coming up. We, as Renew, are the sum of all of you, the individual parties. Your success is our duty, our motivation, our obligation to deliver. In the end, the winner takes it all. And that is why we need to win. And with your help, dear friends, together we can. Liberalism is tattooed. Sounds more Lorinish, I know. Tattooed in our hearts. Liberalism is more than only freedom. It's also about responsibility, social fairness, and equality. And I know for certain that if we speak from our heart and we stand next to each other, united, we will win these elections. And we will all end with the feeling of well, euphoria. Thank you so much. Timmy, thank you. Yeah, oh, come on.
We have. Oh. How about that? I think the people up at the top probably thought I was going to start singing, and they may have heard me last night attempting that, so they cut the mic. Just to thank Malik for his wonderful presentation and look forward to working with him in our joint approach under the Renew platform. We're really happy that so many of our Ukrainian colleagues could be with us for this event, recognizing the pressure and the difficulty that they have in getting here. So I think a big round of applause for the Ukrainian delegation. Now, as all of you know, our two member parties, Kallas and Servant of the People, are represented here by Kira Ruddock, and Olga Stefanishin, the Deputy Prime Minister, is with us. Now, they're both getting a lot of publicity around the world, and whilst they're here, Deputy Prime Minister Stefanishin is highly respected and well recognised. So I think her president was somewhat concerned that she was leading the charge and that she was getting very popular in Europe. So we had a call from him last night, and he said he'd like to make a contribution today. So can I introduce you to President Zelensky, please, who is about to appear on your screens. Thank you.
Dear members of ALDE Congress, dear Europeans, my greetings to all of you. Thank you for supporting freedom for Ukraine and for all of our Europe. Time is now to change, but this is not for our Europe to change. Europe is to stay united, peaceful, free, showing respect to every person, every community, and every country. The time is now to change for those who threaten Europe. They must step back and respect our common values. Our Europe we keep defending, our Europe as a global beacon of freedom, equality, and respect. Our Europe of values will stand. And this is the Europe we will pass on to children of our peoples. Any despot that threatens our Europe or tries to divide or break it must understand he will lose in any confrontation with Europe. Enemies of Europe must know it even before they start a confrontation. Regrettably, for some time, the situation in Europe must seem to present our unity as weak, our values as just written on paper. We have fixed it. Altogether, each and every who is defending freedom against the Russian aggression. Europe now is the strongest ever and can still get stronger. Europe now is the most united ever and can still get more united. Europe now understands more than ever that it is the global European commitment to keep human life at the highest value, not just on our continent. Dear Europeans, freedom does not lose ground only when it gains new ground. So we have to keep defending our values and get them back to the ground in Ukraine, where Russia tyranny dare to come. We have to break existing dividing lines inside our Europe and enlarge the borders of the European project. It is only with Ukraine as a member of the EU and NATO our common European home will become really strong. We have to ensure the level of freedom and protection of life that would be a hope for those in the world who still keep fighting for freedom, for themselves and for their children. And I am confident that this year is ripe and right for decisions. This year can and ought to do everything for our Europe to become the strongest. I thank everyone who is helping. Thank you all who trust in Europe, who make our unity stronger, and have no doubt that freedom must keep the global leadership. Slava Ukraini!
Ladies and gentlemen, please have your seats. We are about to start with the third session by welcoming the two member parties of the parties in Sweden, Liberalerna and Centerpartiet. Please welcome Mr. Pehrson and Muharrem.
Promised a table. So we're going to make use of this one then.
We can use the same, there's no problem.
Yeah.
That's kind of cozy, right?
Yeah. Thank you, everyone. Now, that was obviously quite impressive. So we've got large shoes to fill, I would suggest. Yesterday, we saw this incredible conversation between the Executive Vice President Verstager and Vice President Jourová. And they spoke about all the liberal wins and achievements of the von der Leyen Commission and the remaining priorities. But we only got 1 year left, and then obviously we're going towards new elections. Somebody told us all about the Inspiring Manifesto project that we're working on, which is also going to lead towards those new elections. But no European campaign and no European election without national election. Anyone who has heard me speak before about European elections knows that I always say the European elections are not won in Brussels. They are won all over Europe, in all our EU member states, and obviously we need all our liberal member parties to participate in that. So therefore, it is sort of an addition of all national campaigns. And therefore, in this bit of the program, we would want to talk a bit more about the national focus. Now, we've got 27 countries to choose from, but we have chosen to focus on Sweden. And as luck would have it, this is where we are. We are in Sweden. And we've got two liberal parties here. We've got Liberalerna, and we've got Centerpartiet. And Centerpartiet is represented here by Muharrem, Demirok, and Liberalerna is presented here by Johan, Pehrson. And we are very, very happy to have you here. In our last campaign, after some much deliberation, the focus was climate, climate, climate. And we were very happy to have one focus for the campaign. But obviously the world doesn't stop. And we probably will need new focuses for the next campaign, not to say that we have already dealt with the old ones. So my first question to you would be, from a Swedish perspective, what do you think this topic will be in the elections of 2024? My suggestion might be it will be security, but maybe you have some other ideas, and what if this will bind us together? And I'd like maybe to first give the floor in this case to Muharrem to tell us a little bit about that.
Thank you. And let me start with welcome you all to Sweden and Stockholm. I'm glad to have you. I'm happy to have you here. I'm honored to be able to stand here in front of you as one of the two party leaders for two liberal parties here in Sweden. It's a real delight to see you all. And the party yesterday haven't done anything to you. You look quite full and refreshed. Back to your question, Annelou. We've been through a couple of big things now in the world, unimaginable things. The pandemic, lockdown, a war in Ukraine, in Europe, in the middle of Europe, a horrible war that is tearing this continent apart. And what we have seen is a Europe that is bound together now, stronger than ever. And it's giving us the opportunity to talk more about common values, more about what connects us than divides us. It's giving ground for talking about European political environment. So I think we have a great opportunity to talk about Europe, what unites us, what we can make better. And as we have seen during the past years, when Europe, when the EU, when all of the good forces, when we work together, we can move mountains together. We can do what no one thought was possible. And that is what I want to take into the European election, what bounds us together more than divides us. Okay. But as you said...
But which mountain would you want to move then?
As you said, security is going to be a big issue. Security is going to be a huge issue because it's really, really affecting us all. I'm a father of three. Seeing the pictures on television of hospitals being bombed, of destroyed kindergartens, it does something to you. It does something to all of us. And the security issue is something that also affects everyone in their day-to-day life. So security issue has to be, must be, one of the great topics of the coming elections in Europe. Otherwise, we we've gone wrong somewhere.
Okay. So maybe, Johan, you can't disagree, but maybe you have to add something to this.
I agree. But I also would like to say welcome to Stockholm, to this beautiful place in Europe. I'm happy to see you. I missed the party yesterday at the Vasa Museum. A piece that shows that the Swedish engineer arts has developed, so to say. It's like a hockey stick in development, actually. And now, after Vasa, we do soon, we will deliver, and I hope it will have to be used, unfortunately, the archer system in Ukraine to defend European values. I listened a lot and with very open ears to the starting of this presentation. And if you make this in a condensed formula, I would say that all the speakers before us talked about a Europe that should be greener, stronger, and safer. And these three key cornerstones, key factors, really act together. But I also heard that it has to be understandable among the voters in Europe. It has to be clear, what do we mean with greener, stronger, and more secure and safer? I think also we have to really focus on door by door, area by area. We have to meet people and be very focused on the main issues. It's to win election.
Yeah.
Win this election. And then we have to deliver. And that's what politics is about, to seek support, get support, and then do the most difficult thing. It's to act with responsibility for the support you actually got. Doesn't matter if you're happy or not, you have to act and take responsibility.
So that's maybe lesson number one that we can take here from Sweden to all our national campaigns. Maybe make it a little less lofty and make it a little bit more concrete, if I can sort of summarize your advice. And I think it's a good advice, so I would urge all of you to listen carefully and make some small notes. Now, safety was one of the things that was mentioned by both of you, and obviously we've heard a lot of talk about NATO, which we all support, but what would be the role of the EU in this safety process? Because until now, that hasn't been on the forefront of the European cooperation within the EU. Maybe I'll start with you, Johan.
Liberalerna's point of view in these issues, the most focus should be on the NATO issue. That's the hardware, so to say. But also we should work with safety. We should be able to take our share, to do our part, to do our home lesson in building up the defense, the army, the navy, etc. In Sweden, we have to pay for it. And then we have to be stronger in the way that we have a strong economy that can really pay for the bills, which comes out when we build our part, our responsibility within the NATO zone, not least with the Finns together, which will be our part in the NATO area. And then it works together. But for us, it's very clear that we should do a lot within the European Union, but the focus should be that we should pay our bills and support and do our part in NATO.
So peace doesn't come cheap, no. As we have found out.
You have to pay for it. But it's more expensive if you don't pay the bill.
That's it. It's more expensive to not pay the bill. And also, maybe also from a Swedish perspective in this case, because there are many countries within the EU that do not face this burden so closely as Sweden, because you are on the border of this conflict. So again, this is maybe even more important to a country like Sweden, that there is good EU cooperation in this field.
Of course, but just let me take 1 minute to congratulate our Finnish colleagues for joining NATO. I'm really glad for you. I'm really, really glad for you joining NATO. Uh, But also, I must say, I'm kind of jealous because we're still not a member, but we're getting there. I'm sure we will be there in a short while. But as you said, NATO and the EU are two parts that work together. It's been a stronger cooperation between the two units during the years. And we share not only common values, we also share a common interest when it comes to geopolitics and when it comes to safety issues. And we have to build it stronger on that. Because Sweden, even if we're not a member now, and there's a couple of more countries in Europe that aren't members, we need to rely on a strong European Union, on strong solidarity between us, and build it together with NATO to safeguard our borders, to make sure that peace and prosperity grows all over the continent. Because both EU and NATO are the greatest guarantees for a peaceful future in Europe. So let's build it together. Let's build a stronger EU, and together with that, build a stronger NATO get more peace and prosperity and economic growth in Europe. That's all I have to say about that.
Well, I can't agree with you more. Now, as I mentioned earlier, I mean, we always knew, but it has become more and more apparent to us that safety and security is going to be one of the first things that we need to deal with. But in our last campaign, as I said, the focus was on climate. And even today, this afternoon, there's going to be a panel discussion on the urgency of the climate agenda and energy transition. So even though we've got a new added problem, the old problems haven't gone away. We still need to deal with them. And obviously, Europe is working on it. We've got the Green Deal, Mr. Timmermans. We've got the flagship Fit for 55. And for people who don't know that, this is not some new gym that has opened in Brussels, but it is actually a program to get to the 55% reduction goal in 2030 with all kinds of sort of instruments and tools that you can use. How are you going to approach this in Sweden, Johan?
Can you condense the question? What we do for the climate in Sweden, what we're supposed to, what we should argue to do in Europe together within the...
Well, what you bring to Europe, as you say, if I could ask something from Europe, from a Swedish perspective, when it comes to climate change and energy transition, I would urge that this gets more priority or that they follow our footsteps.
Yes. Yeah, but then I would like to focus on the climate issue, actually. I mean, during the Swedish presidency, the Swedish government, my co-minister, the climate and environmental minister, Ms. Romina Pourmokhtari, she do have a strong focus together with the whole government to fix the last pieces now in the Fit for 55. This is a crucial paper, a crucial new regime that will make it possible to move Europe further in reality. We walk the talk. We will be able to take our share. If we don't take the leadership in Europe, I mean, who should take the leadership in the world then? It won't be China, it won't be Russia, definitely. It will not be the US either, I guess. Even though a lot of the technological developments happens on the east coast of China or the west coast of the US, we have to melt together politics, investments, and the new technology. And I think this is the focus within Fit for 55. So this is... We put in all efforts now to close this, and we have strong discussions with the French government, actually.
And what is your perspective on this?
If I start with saying that I think we all should take a moment just to realize what we are doing now. We're in the process of implementing the biggest climate package in history. And who is doing that? We are. It's our generation. It's you and I, everyone in here. We're doing it together. Everyone, every MEP in the European Parliament, every parliamentary in our member countries, we are doing this together. And I think we need to realize what we are on the verge of making happening here. And it's really interesting to see how we can move it further. But it's also a danger in this, because if we only focus what we are doing, the big process, if we stand at just stand still there, we're going to be kind of lazy. We're going to lean back and say, well, fit for 55, it's going to make it. But what liberals have to do now is lean even further, lean in and say, let's take it even one step further. What's the next step? What are we going to do next year? What are we going to do after we have implemented this package? And Sweden has to be one of the leaders in that competition. We have always been in the forefront when it comes to climate, meeting climate change, and we have also been in the forefront when it comes to making climate change be a driver to economic growth as well. Because what we see now is climate change isn't something theoretically. It's happening right now. We see it all over Europe. We see glaciers melting. We see droughts even in March. We see governments putting restrictions on water use. Climate change is happening now. And if the liberals don't get together, and if countries like Sweden don't lean forward, lean into the transition, nothing is going to happen. Yeah. Someone has to take the leadership. Europeans and liberals, they have to be those leaders. It's not because just because it's the right thing, because it's what's will make
thing.
Peace and prosperity in Europe and in the world. So liberals, get together now and make the climate transition happen.
But yes, but in order, this is obviously something we all want, but in order to make it happen, we need someone to do all the work. Now, Johan, you were also the Minister of Employment. Do we have the labor? Do we have the skills? Do we have the people to do all the work that is necessary? Because you talked about the technology, but the implementation of technology is maybe even more important.
We don't have the skills, not enough. We have to do so much more. We have to invest in people from young years for preschool activities, for kindergartens, up to get the best universities in the world. We have to put up European universities on the rankings. We have to do so much. And we have to upskill and reskill, of course, people who today are within the labor force, because things change so very quickly. I mean, we try to be in the forefront in Sweden. We have this transition package newly launched together with our social partners to really make it able and make it possible for people to upskill or reskill during your working life. But it also starts with the focus on the young, the school activities in younger years. And I arrived yesterday late from Porto, from where we had this social pillar summit. We were really discussing, and I was trying to defend and be very clear that this is, Sweden can't be a blueprint. We have natural history, we have natural, we have different systems, etc. But we must learn from each other. We must focus totally on the investment in education, because otherwise you can the greener and the safer ideas will be undermined, not the least the greener ones. So you have to invest, and then you also have to have a economic development that really makes it possible for governments to really put the money on the table and do this investment in education. And the problem is, we discuss it, everyone says the same. Everyone is for, with no problem. No, who's against skills? No one. But what's happening? It's because it's the return on the investment is not direct. So it takes such a time to make this journey to a more skilled society, but there is no other way I can find, so
no.
You have to do it.
Muharrem, have you got any thoughts on education and the building of skills in regarding to the climate change? And then we, of course, have to finish because I think some people are already leaving the
room. Yes, I would like to take up where Johan left on return on investment and start with a story about a 17-year-old boy. He got on a train from a small town outside of Ankara in Turkey 50 years ago. He was going to Sweden. He knew nothing about Sweden except from what he had read on the postcard that his sister sent back. He went to Sweden, met a young girl, they fell in love. They had five jobs among them. Between those five jobs, they managed to make five kids also. One of the kids is today a lawyer, one of the kids is a teacher, two of the kids are nurses, and one of the kids, standing here talking about labor migrants with European friends. That is what labor migration does. My father and my mother has paid taxes all over, all through the years, and raised five kids. They made an investment in this country. So when we're talking about return of investment, when we're investing in people, we're investing in both getting economic growth, but also humanitarian and democratic growth in the world. So what we have to do is when other forces are looking at closing borders, we have to open borders. We have to see that migrant labor is the future.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Obviously, we could go on forever, but we have to stop it at this point. And I want to wish both of you extreme success in the next European elections, because it's to the benefit of all of us. And in wishing you well here in Sweden, I wish every member party well in the upcoming European elections. And thank you for being here.
Let's give it time.
Thank you.
You're welcome.